Hello, hello. Welcome back to another episode of Drew's Playing Something. This episode, we're talking about Elite Dangerous, which sounds like a game that they just chose a couple random words and put them out there. First off, about this game, it's freaking complex, out the wazoo. It's not as super bad as I'm sure some of the simulate-y things are out there, but there is a lot of stuff going on in this game. And they have a training section, which takes you through some combat training, quite a bit of combat training, actually, I guess, as well as docking and travel training. Now, the training modules themselves are not really very helpful. Basically, what you have to do is, as they link here, you should watch this pilot training video, which takes you to a YouTube page where they have all of these explained with narration, because the actual training inside of the mission is pretty sparse, which kind of leads to my whole issue with this game, is that there really is no, there is no story. There's no, like, you know, plots or characters. I mean, it's basically just a big simulated thing that you're just, you go in there and you kind of make your own stories and all that kind of stuff. And it's basically just figuring out ways to make money in order to make, so you can spend the money and then make more money in a different way. So, you know, I guess if you're really into just that kind of like simulated flight thing, I mean, that's okay, but I would really like for there to be some kind of story involved in it. But that's me. The training courses themselves are not too bad. I can't believe this must be the one that Matt couldn't get past. We were up against two fighters, and it's really not that hard, especially because you have gimbaled weapons, which we'll talk about here in a little bit. I haven't gone all the way through all these trainings. The final combat training is apparently just an expert level. It's like a horde mode. You just get increasingly powerful waves of enemies, and you just go on. I don't know if there's an ending or not, but I haven't really gone that far. I was like, I'm tired of doing all these training things, watching all these stupid videos. Let's go to the game. So let's do just that. Let's go to the game. So there are three different modes. You can do open play, which is basically you're out in the world with other people, and they can be nice to you. They can fuck you. They can do whatever they want, which has its ups and downs. I mean, you know, if people are nice, you can do cool stuff. Like, if you're in trouble, you can put out a distress beacon and they can come aid you. They can give you fuel or help you in a fight or whatever you need to do. On the other hand, if they're dicks, they can just come up and kill you and take all your stuff, which is a viable option as far as making money in this game. There's private group, which is if you have friends, then you can have a galaxy that is just you and your friends, which is kind of cool. And there's solo, which is exactly what you think it is. Offline, NPCs only. And that's what I like to play, believe it or not. So, we will load up my solo game. This is an outline of the ship that I've just bought. You're going to be seeing me on my maiden village of my Eagle ship. I just am about 11 or so hours into the game, and I just got rid of my starter ship and just picked up freshly this new, more combat-focused ship called an Eagle. There's a lot of different ships, and they range anywhere from 30,000 credits up to nearly 200 million credits, which it's not like, you know, the more expensive the ship, the better it is at fighting or anything like that, because it's not a game that focuses on fighting necessarily. There are a lot of different paths you can take in order to make money. Like I said, the whole point of the game is basically just make money so that you can buy other stuff that will allow you to make more money. I'll walk you through really quick just the kind of the HUD here, which looked pretty cool, pretty futuristic. You can see my dick, which is nice, because I have a little bit of a pot belly, which is kind of not cool. But anyway, so over here we have kind of our ship status. We have an outline of what our ship looks like, a representation of our shields and our hull integrity. There's that little tri area right there is how we can manually disperse energy to our different parts of our ship. We'll get into that in a minute. There's a fuel gauge along with our fuel consumption and some indicators to indicate things that are needing to be indicated. This is a module that shows us kind of our status in the world. There are different reputations that you can you can get yourself, you know, aligned with or whatever. I don't know that there's any, like, reason to care about that apart from the accessibility of weapons, ammo, ships. You can get discounts at certain places if you have a high reputation with a certain faction, blah, blah, blah. There's also that rebuy cost you see there. So when you die, you don't necessarily lose everything that you have. If you have enough balance in your credits, you can buy yourself back to be exactly where you were before. So you basically want to make sure that at all times you have enough credits in your balance that if you do die, that you can rebuy yourself. Hey, come back here. You can rebuy yourself your ship back. There are modules. All the things you have installed in the ship, it breaks down their power consumption and what they do, blah, blah, blah. You can toggle them on and off. Like, you know what, I don't think I'm going to be doing any kind of cargo hatching in our playthrough today, so I can just go ahead and shut that off. Of course, you can turn off things like life support, and then you start running out of oxygen, so you got to look out for that. But if you're really in a pinch for fuel consumption, which I I have ran out of fuel out in the middle of nowhere before, and that sucked, but you can turn off your most vital systems and try and get yourself home. I was not successful, but it is something you can do. Fire groups is where you have all of your multiple weapons and or utility things, and you assign them to buttons. I don't know what that does. And that's just stuff. This is where I had to go to self-destruct myself when I was stranded out in the world. Information panel, doesn't really need that. Communications panel, don't really care, so I'm playing by myself. And navigation panel, we'll get into that quite a bit here in a second. So what do you say I show you? So we're parked in a starport at the moment, Bear City, which is somewhere in the fucking universe. At starports, you can do things such as refill your fuel and your ammo, repair your ship. Depending on the capabilities of the starship, you may also be able to do things like modify your ship. So if I go to outfitting, this has all of my weapon emplacements, and you know what, actually, just for the sake of coolness, I kind of want to, I'm going to put this one on top, just so it looks cool. So I've got the two burst lasers down on the bottom, and I've got the multi-can up on top. So burst lasers are weapons, laser weapons in general are good against shields, kinetic weapons, weapons that fire projectiles are good against hulls. I also have a kill warrant scanner because I'm kind of taking on the role of a bounty hunter, which is one of several things that you can do. Although it seems to be early on kind of the easiest way to make money, and you get to get engaged in combat, which is always fun. Internally, there are a lot of things going on, from armor to thrusters to drives and life supports and shield generators and all kinds of stuff that you can swap in and out. Now, depending on your ship, you're going to have more capacity for maybe more weapons or maybe fewer weapons, and then you get more internal capacity. So, like, if you have a big freighter that you want to use to haul goods, you may have a lot more cargo rack capacities and, you know, a lot more space in here for you to put additional units to scan planets or just carry more crap or whatever it is that you do. And then this is just decal stuff. You can buy paint jobs, microtransactions. Awesome. So you basically, you know, yeah, you can buy and equip and sell, and everything has ratings. So basically it's A through whatever. The higher the rating, the typically better-ish the components. And then there's also class. So it kind of gets confusing from what I understand, because ratings, yes, typically an E is better than an I, but a class 1 or class 2I may be better than a class 1E. And better is kind of a tricky term, because while the E may, you know, have a higher DPS, it may draw more power or it may weigh more, blah, 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 blah. So there's a lot of things that go into choosing your weapons. There are also weapons that are some that are gimbaled and some that are stationary. And I started off using the 360 controller, or at least attempting to control the game. But I've since switched to mouse and keyboard, and I've made sure and buy all weapons that are gimbaled weapons, because holy fuck, it is hard to aim the stationary weapons. and you do the tutorials, you can see stationary weapons, they're difficult to aim with, especially with the 360 controller. Mouse and keyboard is a little bit easier, but wow, gimbaled are so much better. Okay, so... All right, I think that we're done with that. You can also buy ships at certain places, not all places, once again. So you can see here, this is the ship you kind of start out with called the Sidewinder. And at any time, if you do die and you're unable to pay for your bill to come back to life, you can start over with a new Sidewinder. That's basically how it starts. You just start over. But always keep enough money in your stuff so that you can come back, hopefully. That's the idea. But you see there, that's actually the ship that I just bought. I don't know why I would say that it's better than the ship that I have, because I just bought that ship. That's weird. And there are ships that are made for, you know, hauler, obviously something that you're going to use to, so it only has one weapon, but it's got two utilities, where we have three weapons and two and one utility. It also has more internal compartments, and their sizes breaking down. It's got a lot of size 3 internal compartments, so you could use that probably to haul more cargo. Let's see. There's a $1 million transporter ship, $4 million who knows what, $17 million, $56 million, $76 million, and it looks like the most expensive one on the docket today is a $146 million, probably a fighter. It looks kind of like a fighter. I don't really know. But... So you can see here, it's got a ton of, wow, large hardpoints, utility mounts, 8 of them. So 2 + 4 + 3 = 7 + 1 = 8. So 8 total weapons and 8 total utilities with one huge hardpoint. I don't even know what that is. Holy shit. So the thing's got a lot of stuff, but cost $147 million. And that price can change, can fluctuate depending on where you are. And just over the course of time, that can also change. But anyway, so ships that are available at this particular port. You can also, from here, there's a commodities market, and as you travel around, it's basically, you know, you want to, if you're going to get into the trading game, which I guess in the end game is where you're going to make the big bucks, is in trading. You get one of those ships that you can carry just a butt ton of stuff, and you can jump for, you know, huge amounts of area, so you can jump from place to place very quickly. So you just buy and sell and watch the markets and, you know, buy things when they're supply is high and the take it to somewhere where the demand is high or whatever, you know, so you play that whole game. But like I said, that's more of an end game kind of thing. When you have a ship that can carry more stuff than what my ship can currently carry, but it's a thing. And then there's also the bulletin board, which is kind of the posting for missions in the game. And this also will change depending upon where you're at, blah, 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 blah. There are available missions that you can take. There are also available missions, but unobtainable. And that may be unobtainable because of your ship type or your reputation with the local people. But there are missions that range everything from... This is basically just a reputation mission. It actually costs you money. You just give them money, and you get nothing in return except for reputation. There are courier missions where you just take things from one place to another. That's kind of the early missions that you'd probably cut your teeth on, is just taking places from one thing to the other. There's kill missions where you just kill pirates. There are also missions where you have to go and find a material and then bring it back or take it to some place. Intense interstellar competition research. Let's see. So it wants us to take it to the Al-Harahi sector. And now we have stolen data. Now, this is one reason why this is going to be a little bit tricky. The goods are prohibited where we are, so I want to make sure and try and leave here without being scanned. Why don't we go ahead and try that and see what happens? Now, one thing you can get yourself in trouble is that your ship may not have the capacity to jump to the place that you need to complete the mission. I've had that happen a couple of times. And then you have to take a hit. You get fined for failing to complete the mission. And all these things, like this one says it has... let's see. Let's look at a different one. So this one, it only have 27 minutes to complete the mission. And if I don't complete the mission in that time, usually what it does is it will dock your cut. So instead of getting 34,000 credits, maybe you'll get only 1,000 credits. And then it will give you another timer. And if you fail to complete it in that next timer, it'll either fail. There are some cases where you may get a fine. Like if they give you something to take somewhere and you don't, I mean, you still have that physical object. So they're like, hey, we're out. We gave you this aluminum to take over to whoever and you didn't deliver. So now if you ever come back here, we're going to fine you because you essentially stole our goods and didn't deliver them where they were supposed to go. And that is real time. So even if you log out of the game, if you don't complete the mission within that time limit in real time, it will fail or whatever, et cetera, et cetera. So you have to be careful not to overexert yourself in the missions that you choose. Is that everything here? I think that's mostly everything here. So we'll go ahead and we kind of did a tour of the ship. So what we'll do is we'll return to the surface. And this particular space station is a pretty nice one. It's one of the bigger, like, you fly into space stations. They kind of run the gambit. You know, if you're in a sector where there's a lot of money and power and federation, whatever, you can get these kind of nice-looking, very large space hangars with a lot of different landing pads and blah, 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 blah. There are also smaller ones that you sort of just land on the outside of and carry on about your business. So we'll go ahead and we'll launch, which will reactivate our engines for us. So we've now got 5 minutes to leave the station. Like I said, it's pretty, you know, don't get too close to other people's pods. Leave the station when you're told, blah, 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 which is kind of interesting and kind of, you know, irritating at the same time. So we'll go ahead and get out of here before, and I forgot that we have, I want to be careful about. So I want to get out of here rather quickly so they don't have time to scan me on my way out. But I want to make sure not to run into that guy, so let's let him clear the path. Then I'm going to hit my engine boost. Actually, I'm going to do that, and then I'm going to hit my engine boost. Maybe, if I can.
Landing gear retracted.
I have a landing gear on, so I couldn't do it. So we get out of here without being scanned, hopefully. Yay! No scanaging. Excellent, excellent. Okay. So there are basically three different speeds at which you travel in. I guess I can show you while we're here. I'll show you the what that space station looks like, maybe, if we don't crash back into it. Pretty big, pretty cool. You know, there's the vagina hole where we flew in, and it's on. It rotates, so you have to kind of be careful when lining yourself to get up into it. But pretty cool little space station. So there are three kind of different speeds of travel. This is your speed that you're traveling at for docking or fighting. It's the slowest speed. You can see down on the right-hand side. Maybe I didn't explain that middle part very well. This is like the radar for when you're out flying. So there are ships, the yellow and orange and all that kind of stuff are different ships and things. If they're red, that means that they're hostile towards you. If they're above the map like this, that means that they're above you in your orientation. They're below the map as they were, that means that they're below you in their orientation. This is where they're pretty much dead on in front of me. I can target them and scan them, get information on them, and we use that when we're looking for bounties on people and all that kind of stuff. To the right of it is our speed indicator. In this case, it's 97, I don't know, something. I mean, who knows what. You throttle up and down using the, you can see that little bar going up and down, but that doesn't really exactly correlate with our speed. There's a little bit of a drag as far as actually speeding up or actually slowing down. And that plays a big role when you're traveling at the next fastest speed, because it's can be kind of tricky to get yourself in the right speed that you want to be at. When that blue zone is where the ship is at an optimal state for turning. So if you're going faster than that, you can't turn as sharply. If you're going slower than that, you can't turn as sharply. So when you're in that blue zone is when you're optimal for turning. That's also used for when you're in the next fastest speed.
Scan detected.
Oh, shit. Oh, shit. That's bad. Oh, shit. No, I got too close. I'm being scanned. Oh, no. They want that to happen. Away from me. Leave me alone. What's he gonna say? He hasn't said that he's successfully scanned me. Maybe I got away from him and he didn't actually get me scanned. I don't know. I want to go away from here. Woo! Okay, so let's go ahead and make our way up to the next fastest speed. And to do that, I first need to pick a navigation point. There are a lot of things that keep you from using your, I think it's FSJ, your phase specter drive something. I don't know. She'll say it here in a second. Mostly that centers around these little things over here. If you're mass locked, that means that you are too close to a planet or a like a dock, and you can't get away. Like you can't phase shift because you're too close to it. You have to have your landing gear. All your stuff has to be in. Your weapons have to be in. Your cargo scoop has to be in. Blah 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 blah. And then we need to pick a destination. So I'm going over here to the navigation panel, and I actually because I've been focusing mostly on doing bounties, I want to see if there is a nav beacon close by. 863 light seconds. That's pretty close. So I'll set that as my destination, and I'll go into super cruise. Charging. So let's see. Where is
Four,
our?
Oh. Three,
we're going to take off. Two, so this should take us to the next fastest speed. So we're going 209, whatever that is. And now we start going into speed of light. So we're at 3 times the speed of light, 5 times the speed of light, ever increasing. Now I want to keep my speed in that blue zone because it's definitely possible to overshoot where you want to go. As you can see, we're getting closer to our thing, 796 light seconds. And you're also affected by gravity. So if that thing is close to the sun, which it looks like it is, or the star, then we might get pulled in by that star's gravity. And even though I throttle all the way back, it doesn't matter because we're just sucked in by the gravity. It'll pull us right past it. So you have to be kind of cautious about that kind of thing, which is kind of neat. I think the game does a good job of sort of portraying the scale of space. Like all these planets and things are all like, they're very small, you know, compared to even the star at the center of the galaxy. It just looks tiny because this system is just huge. And I mean, in travel from one to the other, you fly by a planet and they just look so small because they are so small in comparison to, you know, actual space. And it does take a long time sometimes to fly from place to place. I mean, if you have to, sorry, I've got kind of a cold. If you go to a station or you go to a system and the dock that you need to go to is 100,000 light seconds from where you land, then it's just kind of like, well, fuck, you know, that sucks. Because it's going to take you forever to fly out there. Even if you're going, you know, 40 times the speed of light, it still takes you several minutes to get out to that point. So, basically what we're doing now, as a bounty hunter, now I took that job, but I've got 18-something hours to do it, so I'll worry about that here in a little bit. First off, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to show you kind of like how you operate as a bounty hunter. One of the easiest ways to operate as a bounty hunter is to go someplace where there are a lot of ships, and then look for people that have bounties on them. So that's exactly what we're going to do. Nav beacons are always a good place that have a lot of ships coming and going. You can also go to places like mining areas or resource pockets, but you're more likely to run into more difficult enemies or groups of enemies. So nav beacons are usually a good place where you can kind of single out a single target and get them by themselves and destroy them. All right, so I've got the right speed and the right distance, so now I'm going to leave that speed and go back down to our sort of combat docking speed. And we're here with a lot of ships, which is good. And what I want to do is sort of look around at the different ships. Let me get my weapons out first, just to be safe. I have come in and just instantly been like attacked. Now this guy, as you can see on the left there, he is wanted, so he has a bounty. So I'm going to scan him with my warrant scanner to make sure I get the maximum amount possible. All right, that's complete. So now it's just a matter of positioning myself in a good place behind him. She's going pretty fast, so I want to make sure and get... Now, gimbaled weapons, you can see those little crosshairs like kind of floating around all over the place. And that's because... gimbaled weapons will sort of help you aim, which is very nice. Wow, this guy is fucking flying fast. Come on, guy. I'm having to constantly use my boost just to even catch up with him. Now, typically, now they can, like, fly away from you. I mean, they can try and escape. They all have, you know, frame shift drives as well. And they definitely can try and escape you. But this guy,
target shields
usually once you engage them, they will attempt to fight back. So what I'm doing when I'm fighting is I'm constantly shifting between power to my weapons and power to my engines. So I power up my engines when I want to go faster. I power up my weapons when I'm actually firing. Now,
Target shields online.
Always shield your back.
Target shields offline.
And they're gone again. You can also do so. Weapons make your basically what they do is they your kinetic weapons like my chain gun will refill faster. Like when they have to reload, they'll reload faster, and my other weapons, my lasers, will cool down faster or recharge
target
faster. So you can see on the right
online.
There that my multi-cannon is using up bullets
target
and having to reload.
Offline.
My burst lasers are having to... Where are you going? Come back here. Why am I going so slow? Let's go a little bit faster. All right,
target
so 20,000 credits for blowing up that guy. Not too bad. So what I'm doing is, my system is basically my shield. I'm looking at my icons over here, system, engine, and weapons. System is basically my shield, and since I wasn't getting attacked at any point in there, I basically put no power into it. I use my engine when I want to go faster, so if you see my speed there right now, I'm at 106. If I switch to my weapons, I go down to 94, but I stay in the blue zone, which means that I'm at my peak of cornering, which is important. So if I need to corner faster, I can just pump up my engines, and I can corner and go faster or catch up to someone. And then once I have them in my sights, I switch over to weapon power, and then I blast the shit out of them. That's basically what I do. But what that means is that I'm not really able to easily control my speed manually, like my actual throttle, because to at least the way that the default keys are set up, to switch power is the arrow keys, and if you hit down, you reset all of them back to where they originally are. So you hit down to, or I'm sorry, use the arrow keys to, adjust where your power is, and then you use WASD to, actually control your craft. So I'm kind of not able to have my hand on both of them at the same time. I'm sure you could, adjust it in some way to, you know, I'm using my buttons on my mouse a lot, but I'm using them for things that are not that. I could probably, I should probably bind those engine weapon system keys to my mouse in some way, so that I can use them and have my left hand still on my navigation. That's probably something I should do. I'll think about it. I'm sure if you had like one of the cool, like, you know, what we got going on over here? You got a thing on you? Nope, you're good.
Target shields offline.
Who are you? So I'm sure if I had a cool, like, you know, joystick and controller and all that kind of stuff that I could. So I'm looking for people who have wanted, and this guy's clean, so I don't want to attack him. I want to find people who are wanted. So
target
I kind of
shields
go to the next
online.
Target, and I have to stare at them for a little bit so that it picks up whether they're wanted or not. He's clean. It also shows me if they are, so if someone's scanning me, that's fine. I don't really have anything that they could find out about me. So this guy is wanted, but he has three people in his crew, so it's a little bit risky to take him on, but I think we're going to do it. Sometimes their crew isn't actually with them. There's also someone else already shooting them, so I don't feel too nervous about taking him on. He's a competent pilot, not an expert or deadly or anything like that, so he might not be too bad to take out. So he's getting away from me a little bit, so I'm going to switch to my weapon.
Up
my engine a bit. Come back here, you. All right, follow him on the radar.
Frame shift
switch
charge
back
detected.
To weapons. Oh, he's trying to leave. There's a way to target subsystems so that you can just keep him from taking off. I'm going to be honest, I don't really know how to do that. Should probably look that up. I'm sure it's some kind of strange binding somewhere. So he's gone. He took off. I should figure out how to do that. And also, a lot of times they'll leave behind a thing you can scan if you have the proper equipment to figure out where they went. In this case, it seems like he did that.
Target shields offline.
Maybe that's just me. Anyway, that's the first time anyone's ever gotten away from me. I'll have to look in the key bindings and see, because you can target like specific portions of their ship in order to stop them from, you know, you can cut out their shields, make them keep them from recharging, or cut out their engines so they can't move anymore, all that kind of stuff. So anyway, that's basically bounty hunting. You just kind of go to places where there are a lot of ships, and then a lot of times, even if you just scanning someone, and they'll instantly start attacking you because they know that you're going to. So he's going to be leaving. shortly, which is fine. He's not important to me. Not wanted anyway. And that's kind of the easy combat way to start off making money. You probably want to do like bounties to start off with, but then once you sort
target
of, you know, upgrade your ship
online
a little bit, maybe get some better weapons, then you can start doing bounties.
Target shields offline.
Looks like we scanned everyone
target
here and there's no one left.
Offline.
So I think next what we'll do...
Target shields offline.
Alright, shut up, lady.
Target shields offline.
Next what we'll do, I think, I'm going to look at completing that mission that we got. So, from the navigation beacon again, we'll just sort of hang out in this direction. You can pick things that are a local stuff to check out easily from here. But if you want to go outside of this system... you can, or if you, I guess you can get a more detailed look at the system map if you go into it, and that will show you all of the different places within the system. It'll give you a breakdown of kind of like their resources that they have available and all their kind of environments and everything. You can go to, what is this? Why do I have a mission there? I have a mission there? I don't know why I have a mission there. You can check out the different terminals and see what they have for imports and what they want to import and what they have to export and all that kind of stuff. That's where that plays into that economy thing. What is my mission that I have there? So that's the system map. What am I doing? We received word that a blah 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 share the wealth, just don't get spotted. Trade data stolen, system starport. So wait, do I not have the stuff and I have to get it? I get so confused by this. Am I already in the Alahari section? It's kind of confusing. I'm confused. So let's go back over here to this side. Do I have any cargo? No, I don't think so. So I don't actually have any data. I guess I have to find it and then bring it back. Maybe that's why that scan didn't matter, because I didn't actually have anything. So this is where things get confusing. Fucking missions don't make any sense. I don't know where to find stolen trade data. How would I know how to do that? And then there's sometimes you get like an assassination mission to like go to this sector or go to this system and find someone and just and kill them, and I'm like, you just go there and there's nothing. There's no waypoints, you know, there's no way to find them. I guess what you're supposed to do is just go around and find like unidentified signal sources and go check them all, and eventually you'll find the guy you're supposed to find. I don't know. It's very non-structured. It definitely doesn't hold your hand in doing a lot of things. Which can be irritating or can be good, I guess, depending on your outlook on life. For me, it's kind of irritating, but it looks like I'm supposed to find trade data illicitly and then bring it back to the station, which I don't really know how to do or that I really want to do. So I'll probably end up abandoning that one. There's no penalty for abandoning it. But what I'm going to show you is, okay, so you've got your system map, which shows you the planets within the system you're in and all of the things that you can do from there, all the different terminals or whatever and blah, 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 blah. But there's also the galaxy map, and this sumbitch is something serious. Oh, wait, maybe I am supposed to go. Do I have to get it from there and then bring it back to here? Maybe that's what I'm doing. Anyway, so this is kind of the local area that I'm in, and I kind of got distracted by a mission to haul some stuff further than I really should have, and I ended up way off the beaten path. I'm not really sure where I started in all this mess, and yeah, it is a mess. So this is just kind of the local section that that I'm in, and I can keep on zooming out, keep on zooming out, keep on zooming out. I mean, this is a serious, serious, serious business. I mean, huge. There's the galaxy. I mean, wow. Zoom back in to where we are. Just absolute insanity, the number of places that you can go. You can also look at this as far as like the allegiances of different planets you're in, these trade things. I don't really know what they show. It's like the different things and where they're traded from. So if you need to find food or something for a quest, then you can sort of figure it out in that direction. But yeah, it's just just an absolute massive game. And I have no idea where I actually started the game at. But now I'm here, which seems fine. I don't know how to get back to where I started, though. Not that it really matters, but at least... So the lines that are drawn in between the places are limited by your ship capacity. And it can sort of plan routes for you. Like, let's say I wanted to go to this Malik place. So I can have it plot a route for me. Hello? Hello? And it will say, okay, I need to jump here, and then to here, and then to here, and then to here, and then to here. And then you can jump all those places to get to the place you want to go. Looks like we probably want to go here. So you can also go ahead and look at the system map if you have that data for the system you're going to. And it doesn't seem as though there's anything here. So I don't really know what I'm supposed to do with that mission. But you know what? We'll go ahead and jump to that place anyway. So I actually don't want to go to Malik. Okay, how do I make you stop? I don't want to go to Malik. Look, undo the Malik-ing. Thank you. Maybe. I want to go to here, please. Okay, so now that is my destination. So we'll go back to the... Hopefully I haven't blown up or done something stupid while I've been not paying attention. So then it will show us on our compass down here where our place is. If it's a hollow dot, that means that the destination is behind us. So we have to, it's behind us. We have to navigate ourselves until the dot is solid. And it'll show us where we want to go. So this place is 6.79 light years away. At this speed, it's going to take us over a year to get there. And that's a real time year. And you can see it's going to use up some of our fuel. That blue area is going to be how much fuel we use. And the distance you can travel is decided by the amount of fuel capacity your ship has. And other things like how much your cargo weighs will decrease how far you can go. So anyway, I'm going to line myself up with that. I'm going to...
Cannot comply.
Oops, I have to put my weapons away because I can't have those out when I frameshift.
Frame
so now I can charge
charging.
Up my frameshift drive. And this will show us the third level of speed, which is the system-to-system travel. So there's kind of a dogfighting landing speed. There's a within the system traveling if you're going from planets to planets.
To engage.
And then this is the speed for going from system to system. And it's basically your
engage.
Star Trek, Star Wars, warp speed kind of deal. And then it will take you, it always takes you to the main sun in the system. I don't know if that's like, you know, there's some lore to that, like it's how the technology works that always takes you to that particular place. But like I said, a lot of times that can suck cock because the places you need to go may not be close to the center of the system. You may have to go to one of the outlying planets, and that can take a long time to get to those places. So we're here where it seemed to think that we should have gone, and I don't really know what the next step in this mission is supposed to be. Now, if we were going on to another system, it would just have another dot for us to go to, and then we would just lock onto that, and then we would go. But there is actually another dot for us to go to. Why is there another dot for us to go to? Where are we? I get so confused by all this. No, I don't want to go to Malik. It's still sending me to Malik. I don't want to go to fucking Malik. I want to be here, I think. Right? That's where I'm at? Yeah, that's where I'm at. It says that there's a mission here, and I've only got one mission to do, so... okay, so let's see if there are any... nothing. There's nothing exciting. Like, I thought maybe there would be a source. I think you just kind of have to fly around until you happen to stumble upon a source or something, and I don't have time for that. And I'm not going to waste your time doing that. But that basically shows kind of the basics of how the game works. So we're flying 11 times the speed of light, and you can see the sun's gotten quite a bit smaller, and we'll just fly past it like it's nothing because, you know, we're traveling super fast, and there's a lot of space in space. Which is pretty cool. Oh, I can turn lights on. Can I turn lights on? What does that do? I think there are lights in the ship, but I don't really know why to turn them on or how to turn them on. Anyway, I've rambled on long enough probably. It's a pretty cool game. Is it worth the $60 asking price? I don't know. I got it for $45 or so in the sale, and you know, because Matt kind of suggested that I should try it out. it's a good basis for a game. I mean, I like flight simulators. I like space sim simulators. They're pretty cool. And this one's not so complicated that it's impossible to do. I said there are a lot of options as far as how you want to make money. You can, instead of getting a bounty scanner, you can get a cargo scanner, and you can become a smuggling pirate. So instead of me, you know, scanning ships looking for bounties, you scan the ships and you examine their cargo. And if they've got good cargo, then you fuck them up and you take their cargo and you go sell it in the black market, which is a different market than the regular commodity market. Only some places have black market dealers, so you have to find those places and go to them. So it's definitely, you know, an interesting game. You can do that. You can become a miner. You go to the mining places. You just mine some ore. You take it to the place that it has a lot of, you know, need, and then you go home. Or you can just do bounties all day, or jobs. So it's definitely a multifaceted game. Like I said, there's kind of a definite tier to like how to make the most money. You kind of start out doing what I'm doing, just kind of getting bounties, turning them in, doing all that kind of stuff, and then the end game is to kind of get one of those big haulers and start really playing the market. But like I said, the only end game is to make more money. That's the only goal, is just, you know, all you do is end up making more money for reasons that are very confusing to me. What am I doing? I want to go to Verbigny.
Frameshift drive charging.
Where's it at? It's over here. So anyway, it's a cool game. I wish it had more like direction, more story. I wish it just kind of had something to do other than just make money to make money. The combat's pretty cool, but it's definitely better with gimbal weapons than with non-gimbal weapons. But I don't know if that's enough to just, you know, go to a nav beacon or go to a resource beacon and just kind of hang out and kill bounties all day and then go back to the spaceship and refill your ammo and your fuel and turn in your bounties and, you know, just rinse repeat repeatedly. Getting better ships, sure, but, you know, I mean, I don't know. Worth $60? Probably not, but pretty fun. And, you know, this is a game that I think was out on, like, you know, early access, beta access, a lot of stuff like that. And they really, you know, have improved it and changed it a lot since its, you know, beginnings. So maybe in the future there'll be something better. And, you know, it'll be really fun to play with my new Oculus Rift. Ha ha ha. So anyway, I've rambled on long enough. I'm going to get out of here. I'm going to go refuel my ship, maybe turn in that bounty that I got, and probably play some more Witcher 3. Anyway, bud, I'll talk to you later. Peace. Ho-ho, fooled ya. You thought we were done? We are not. A few minutes after I decided to stop recording while I was on my way here to Archimbault, I had a little event occur that I thought I would share with you. It's called an interdiction, and basically means that someone is trying to suck me out of hyperspace and then have their way with me, the bastards. To avoid that, you just kind of keep your crosshair pointed towards this escape vector, which moves all over the place. And I assume that it looks like the closer you are to it, the more like of those inner rings sort of fill up with blue. And the more inner rings are filled up with blue, the faster the blue bar on the left fills up. Excuse me, I kind of got the burps. And the red bar goes down. And I would assume that if the red bar fills up, then you don't succeed and you're sucked out of hyperorbit and someone's there, which has actually happened to me one time. I didn't know what was going on the first time it happened. I'm like, what the heck, what the deuce? And he did pull me out of hyperspace or whatever this thing is called. And it was just some guy, one ship, wasn't even hostile towards me, didn't attack me, just hung out. And I was like, well, okay, this is awkward. So I scanned him, and he had a bounty on him, so I decided to kill him, and I did, and collect his bounty. So that can't happen. It's just a random thing. I think that in the 11 or so hours I played, it's probably happened maybe 4 or 5 times. And actually, it happens again right here before I make it to the ship. But you can, you know, I didn't mention earlier, but there are like the unidentified sources and things that you can investigate. And I'm sure that that is probably something that is a semi-big part of the game, I guess. But you have to be kind of careful doing that. Like, that's kind of the thing where you can go and you'll find cargo or you'll find something like that. And there are NPCs that will come up and you'll see on your little field sometimes, like, hey, follow me, or, you know, let me lead you over here. And I haven't actually explored any of those avenues, but it is something you can do. I did have one instance where I explored a strong signal source, which is apparently a very good way to get yourself killed, I have hints found out. Because I got to the signal source and I was like, oh, look, there's gold everywhere. Awesome.
Let me figure out. Let's see. There's some button I have to push to get my cargo scoop out. So I went into the menus to try and figure out how to get my cargo scoop out. And unbeknownst to me, that does not actually pause the game. And I didn't notice it. But if you watch the radar, you can see that about like four apparently very strong ships show up. And they very quickly decimate me. So that was a good learning experience. But there are kind of, you know, random encounters and kind of strange random things that will happen that can liven up the game if you decide to, you know, investigate them or take advantage of them. You know, maybe next time I see someone comes along and they're like, hey, follow me. I'll try and figure out where they are and try and follow them. Because I don't know, like, if they leave hyperspace and I leave hyperspace, we're probably going to be, because we're traveling so fast in hyperspace, we're probably going to be like 400 million miles apart from each other. But, you know, regardless, whatever. So let's see. I've escaped that other interdiction, and I don't know if I talked about the alignments on the left and right. You want to have those in the blue before you disappear your distance and your speed. I probably did, but that's how you come out of hyperspace near where you want to be. I at one time kind of overshot a little bit, but still came out of hyperspace, and I was about 50 kilometers away from my target, which is a lot. So most places when you want to dock, first you need to request clearance, which I'm doing here, bringing them up, saying I want to request docking. They will agree or disagree, I guess. Most times you have to be within a certain distance, like you have to be within 7,000 or 7,500 kilometers to communicate with the base. Then it'll highlight where your landing pad is. And this is a place that is in a less conventional kind of area. As you can see, the pirate skulls, this is a non-regulated system. So there aren't a lot of police around here. And I tried to guess which way was supposed to be forward, because you have to be facing a certain direction, and I guessed wrong. Basically, you just maneuver yourself up. To somewhere approximating where you are in the center of the Dufang. And then, so there's a lot of controls controlling the ship. You can go just vertical up and down. I'm actually backwards. I should be seeing the ass end of my ship, and I'm seeing the front. And turning around when you're not having any forward momentum is a real pain in the ass. Like, this is one, so you can swivel left to right like that. Obviously, you can rotate and gimbal. I think this way is faster. It may not be, but it seems faster. At least it seems like I'm doing something. So then all it is you can see kind of the bullseye there on the bottom. I have to line up my little dot underneath my ship into that bullseye till it turns blue and make sure my landing gear is out, and then come down in the center of that. And, you know, moving in a 3D space, the tilt and the direction of your ship when you're coming down changes your ultimate destination. Docking so just get in the center, land it down, engines and there disengage. You go. Now you can access all the starport services. Anyway, that's it. Hope you enjoyed this little peek at Elite Dangerous. I'll talk to you later. Peace. For real this time.